Give God a hand clap of praise.
Bring some information that I hope has been beneficial to you from the book of Judges. For the last few weeks in a sermon series entitled Here Come the Judges. We've talked about how God takes people who are fractured and wounded and broken and down on themselves and lack esteem and pity themselves. And how God takes those people and he shapes them into leaders. He makes them better than they ever thought they could be. Which only happens in the refiner's fire that God has. When God's going to make you and shape you and fix you for his purpose, he first has to get all of that stuff off of you that you carry around, that we carry around. Darrell Coley said, he's preparing me. He's pruning me. Tuning me. I like when he says he rearranging me. The order that I had was actually disorder. God knows how to straighten that out. Now, these are people who would not have shown up on any radar screen. You had done a list of top 100 leaders, they would not have appeared. And yet God blesses them to the extent that when the writer of Hebrews drafted a Hero's Hall of Fame, when he put the yearbook together, he included these fractured, broken people in the all-star list. And how do you go from being not a bench warmer, not even the water boy? How do you go from being not on the team to being the superstar. Only God can do that. Only God can have stories written about you hundreds of years later because of the degree of your faith. And if you look in Hebrew, chapter 11, verse 32, there's a list of heroes of faith. Verse 31 even mentions a prostitute named Rahab. Then verse 32 says, and what more shall I say? For I don't have time to tell you about Gideon and about Barak and about Samson and about Jephthah and about Samuel also and all the other prophets. I'm just amazed, church, that God can take nothing and make something. I'm amazed at that. God can take something that appears to be at its end and make it the beginning. And the reason I'm amazed, because I still know that people are struggling today with their station in life, what they believe the world has given them. Their lot in life seems to be less than they need or want. And so I came to tell you today that God's not finished. God is still on the throne. He still needs leaders. He's still raising folk. Still empowering people to do dynamic things. He still got thousands of believers everywhere. Dare I say millions? Though you don't see them, wherever you are, you're not alone. They might not be wearing their "What Would Jesus Band Do?" "What Would Jesus Do Band?" But they are around you. They're there to assist you and help you and support you. But even if you don't have anybody else who's ready to identify with the Lord, if you got the Lord on your side, you got all you need. You got more than enough. In fact, it's an unfair advantage for the other side. If you got the Lord on your side, you have the majority with you. You just got to make sure you got the Lord on your side. Don't worry about the times. Don't worry about how evil it looks. It is. Don't worry about how wrong folk can treat you. They will. Don't worry about the meager resources you have. God's still able. He still owns everything. Still possesses everything. And so if you're with God, you can't be in lack. If you're with Him, you can be assured that He will supply your every need if you're with Him. He'll take care of you. I've told you about Gideon, and I've told you about Deborah. Deborah would have been the head of this women's march they had a few weeks ago. She would have been in D.C., standing at the White House. But Deborah was so bad that not only would there have been thousands of women, there would have also been thousands of men. That's how bad Deborah was. That's why she got her name in the Hero's Book of Faith. But I started telling you last week about one who wasn't born lacking. He was born with a silver spoon in his mouth. He was born promised to greatness before he was born. God had promised his mama that he's going to be dynamic. See, not everybody comes out of poverty. Not everybody comes scratching and scraping. That can't be the testimony of some folk. If we're honest with ourselves, there's some folk in here who've never known a day without having everything they needed. It's vogue to act like you've been through some. Everybody got to have a woe is me testimony. That makes you comfortable around folk. But everybody ain't been down and out. Some folk came straight out of daddy's house into somebody else's house, taking care of every step of the way. That's life. And even if they say times were hard, you never known a day without a meal on the table. You never known a day when the clothes you needed weren't there. You've never known that. And so I came to tell you today to liberate yourself. Get off the woe is me train. And get on the he's been good to me train. Because that's a testimony too. I don't know why everybody got to be, you know, ghettoed out in their life. You know, we used to have a cake of cornbread for the whole family to eat. No. If God gave you a pot of beans every day and a piece of meat, tell somebody. Tell the young folk that everybody don't have to go through something. God can keep you. God has kept me. From the day I was born, I had everything I needed. Since that day, I've had everything I needed in spite of myself. Samson was raised in a household where everything he needed was provided for him. First of all, he had older parents. They had gotten all that playing out of him. They weren't trying to compete with the children and go where they were settled. They knew the power of three hots every day. They knew the power of bedtime. They knew the power of all that. This is the environment that Samson came into. They knew the power of being settled and content and appreciating what God had, besides the fact that God had already told them that Samson was going to be something special. That's the family he was born into. He had every privilege one could think of. Many advantages that other kids at that time would not have had. And despite the fact that he had everything he needed, despite the fact that God had a call on his life before he was even conceived, despite the fact that he never knew a moment of lack, despite the fact that he came out on the top rung, he messed up. So I came to relieve some parents today. Because you've been kicking yourself, saying, what could I have done different? Nothing. What could I have given differently? Should I have read him two more bedtime stories at night? Should I have made him eat his carrots and peas, even if he didn't like to? Should I have made sure he went to the zoo two more times? You're kicking yourself over what you could have done differently. And I came to tell you, at a certain point, nothing. Because everybody's got to make their own choices. And even when you're born with a silver spoon in your mouth, you got the choice to change that spoon to a foot. if you want to. And that's what Samson did. He was born at a time in Israel's history that would have read like an AL.com page. People getting killed left and right. Poverty run amok. Malfeasance and misfeasance in high places. People questioning not only whether there is a God, but what God that ought to be. Men were lovers of themselves and each other. There was evil going on. Some people would have called it a dark period. And it was. The Philistines had been in charge of the Israelites for 20 years and had imposed their economic structure over their entire community. In other words, the Hebrews could not move without going through the Philistine pocketbook. And so they had them, bought and sold. This is the environment that Samson was bought into. And yet, despite the fact that he was brought into this, the scripture intelligently tells us that Samson was brought in to start the rescue of his people. That was the purpose of his birth. He was brought in to get it started because God's about to reclaim his people. And just like the other prophets and judges that had come before him, God had a special call on Samson's life. And at the times that Samson needed it, the Spirit of the Lord would come upon him and he would have all the power and strength and wisdom that he needed in order to do what God purposed him to do. They were in the seventh period of apostasy. The nation had rebelled and repented seven previous times. God would allow them to be punished and then he would rescue them because he loves them. Ingrid, they were their own worst enemy. It was dark. But Samson's name means sunshine. And in the darkest time, God will always send a ray of hope. This time, he sent the sunshine to them. But not only was his name given for direction, from before his birth, he was a Nazarite. His mama followed the Nazarite oath as best she could prior to delivering him. She didn't eat anything that came from a vine. Nothing. Not the grape, not the grape seed, not the skin off the grape. She wouldn't go in a vineyard. She kept the promise that she was sworn to by the angel of the Lord. She wouldn't go near a dead body. And then he was born. And as his protector, they made sure he kept the Nazarite promises. He cried, but they couldn't give him no fruit juice. They had to come up with something else to soothe their baby because he was a Nazarite. And even though the other kids laughed at him and talked about him, they wouldn't cut his hair. The questions always came, is that a boy or is that a girl? He just had to get to the point where he could endure that. Scripture was pretty adamant at that time that a man wasn't supposed to wear his hair long. In fact, 1 Corinthians 11:14 says, "Doth not even nature itself teach you that if a man have long hair, it is a shame unto him?" This chauvinistic society didn't like crossing genders. And so men didn't even wear their hair long. And yet Samson, born of privilege and promise, deliberately wore his hair long because it was his testimony to God that he was set aside. Regardless of what everybody else thinks, I'm testifying by my very appearance that I belong to God. I want everybody to know that I've been set apart for the divine purposes of God. Regardless of the ridicule and the shame, I belong to God. And so you ask yourself, was he given great strength all the time? The Bible says, as we go through this, on one occasion, he was able to kill 1,000 Philistines by himself, with his weapon only being the jawbone of a donkey. He killed 1,000 men by himself because God gave him that kind of strength. On another occasion, he was able to pick up the city gates, not the wall that Trump wants to build. Though if God had said it, he could have picked that up too. But the whole gate that led into a city, he was able to pick that up and carry it up a hill on his shoulders. There was also a time when he was confronted by a lion, and he killed the lion with his bare hand, tore it open. This is the kind of strength that he possessed. And so you ask yourself, did he look like a bodybuilder with that long hair? Seems like all of them try to wear their hair long now. Got that Samson thing going on. They better read the whole story. Did he look like one of them old Arnold Schwarzenegger movies? And I believe this. I believe the answer is no. I don't believe he looked like that. I believe he looked like an average man. And the reason I know this is because there was nothing apparent about him and his strength. And the reason I know that's the case is because as we go through this scripture, the reason he got in trouble is because Delilah had to search for the source of his strength. It wasn't apparent in his biceps or triceps. She had to find out, what's the source of your strength? When those big bodybuilders come up, it's pretty apparent. They've been in Planet Fitness for a little while. The source of his strength was the Lord. And the Bible says that the Lord came upon him. And once the Lord comes upon you, look out. He was strong in body when the Lord came about him. But Fred, he was also strong in spirit and in mind. Because when the Lord came about him, he gave him the whole package. He was wise, cunning, sarcastic, loved riddles. If you go through and read it, he would put riddles on folk that they couldn't solve. He was playful, all the package, rich, fun-loving, loved to be around, but he had a problem. See, the problem is, despite his upbringing, despite the fact that his parents gave him everything he could have, despite the fact that the Nazarite vows were kept by his parents until he got to the point that he was responsible for keeping them, despite all these positive things, he had a problem, Denise. He had a problem in that, and it's a common problem in the Bible. See, he was bold and strong before men, but he was weak for women. All this big old man meat standing in front of you, and he just puddles up. when a woman comes around him. And he didn't just like women, he loved ghetto women. All right? He didn't want to find her in the church. He was raised by women, with women in the church. There were plenty of Marys and Margarets. There were plenty of them. He wanted some Delilahs. He walked from the church to the club and lost his mind. Saw her standing over there full of tats. Oh, come on now. You know she has some tattoos. One of them probably already said Samson.
All right.
You the one. Come here. I'm sorry if you got a tat. But I'm going to tell you, the story you tell yourself at 20 about your tat is not going to hold up at 50. It's not going to be the same story. In fact, round 30-something, you're going to start trying to rearrange that story. That's a generational thing. Yeah, yeah. And as soon as Junior or Jill walk in the room and ask you for lunch money and money for a tat, you're going to rearrange your conversation. Yeah. So he was bold. Let me read this for you. She said, verse 15, chapter 14, she said, then she said to him, how can you say I love you, when you won't confide in me? Can't you just see her standing there twirling her hair? You say you love me, but you won't tell me nothing. This is the third time you made me look bad in front of my family. You won't even tell me why you're so strong. And he's sitting there saying, no, see. It was that mule, Paul. No, he's saying, no, see. You know I love you, girl. I drink your bath water. But I can't tell you why I'm so strong. I just can't do it. He couldn't tell her. Three times she came to him. Didn't know that her brother, see, this the problem. Let me just go on and get this out. Right? He wasn't supposed to deal with the Philistines in the first place. He wasn't supposed to be there. And the Bible says he was doing fine. If you follow verse chapter 14, Judges, it's great. You'll love it. It's great reading. He happened to be out one day and went through the city of the Philistines, and he saw a girl that he wasn't supposed to be around. This was the first one, not the last one. All right, this is when we knew he had a problem. He didn't even get the first one and ended up killing all sorts of folk behind her. This is how we knew he had a character flaw. See, he has a character flaw. The character flaw is, even though he's got the Lord on his side, he can't control himself. He can't control his emotions. He can't control his desires and his passions. And because he can't control his passions, it doesn't matter how talented he is. It doesn't matter how much of the Lord he's got on him. Since he cannot control his passions, he's going to ruin his life. It was just a matter of time before he did it. We saw it when he went to the Philistines' homeland the first time, and he looked over and he saw the young lady, and he was so taken by her that he ran back to his mom and dad and said, I got to have her. come on, get whatever the dowry is together. We got to go. I need to see and get it together so we can go back over there and you can get her from me. That's exactly what Samson did. Now, his mom and daddy said, like mamas and daddies would say, if you go back and read it, they tried to do the right thing. They said, son, ain't there a nice girl down there at the church? What about my daughter? They trying to give all sorts of recommendation. Huh? You know Monica? They trying to call names. That's a good girl. And he's standing there with his arm crossed, pouting. I want her. And like any spoiled brat, mom and daddy do what they can do to get him what he asked for, but not what he needs. Hello, he still needs to be guarded. When your child is begging for something that's going to lead to their detriment, you still need to protect them. Clearly, their judgment is off. And so they go. They go over to the land. The girl of Timnath. And they talk to her folks, and they arrange a wedding. And to make a long story short, while they're there, he can't help but be himself. He got to show everybody he's smarter than everybody else. And so he comes up with a riddle because he's into it with the wedding guests. And he offers them a riddle that only he knows the answer to. No other living person can know the answer to it. He knows it. And he gives them a riddle. And the riddle has to do with the fact that he's already violated his Nazirite vows. And when they can't solve the riddle, this is why you can't marry folk out of different communities. Because when they can't solve the riddle, they're about to owe him a lot of money. We'll just say that it's not money, it's really wardrobe. When they can't solve it, they go put the pressure on their sister. And they say, you about to have us jacked up around here. You bring this boy up in here, we don't even know from over there, and he's going to take all our stuff unless you find out the answer to this riddle. And that's when she goes in there. That's when we find out he's weak. Because she goes in and she puts the press on him. And with just a little pressure, he tells her the secret. Tells her the answer to the riddle. And she goes back. And she tells them, and they solve the riddle, and he gets so angry because she told them what was going on that he goes to another town and kills 30 men. Oh, he's got a problem. This man of so much promise also has a problem. He kills 30 men, takes all their stuff, and gives it to her brothers and cousins. He got a problem. But his problem is he's weak. So let me give you this and let me get out of your way because Samson is the problem we've got today, but people still got this problem. See, the first thing that Solomon messed up, we found out that he's bold before men, but he's weak before women. The first thing he did was dishonor his parents. Oh, he dishonored his parents. He did. Sunshine was his name, but he liked dibbling in the darkness. All right. Three people sitting in the seat right there where you are right now. Three people. It's the person you are right now. That's the you are right now. It's the you could be for the Lord or the you could be for the devil. You got to decide which one you're going to be. You don't have to stay the you are. The Lord will bless you. Or the devil will use you. Samson decided he was going to go with the devil. And the surest way of doing that is walking away from your upbringing. It's the surest way. If you had a decent home upbringing, And he did now. We talked about that. I talked about that. He had a good upbringing, but he dishonored his parents. This is the first step in his downward journey. He had godly parents. Everybody would agree with that. They pleaded for him to do right. They didn't want him to go and pull a girlfriend or a wife from a place that was not good for him. They didn't want him to be unequally yoked in terms of marriage. You tell your children all the time, baby, I just don't think that's going to be no good deal. And guess what? They do what they want to do and want you to clean it up when it goes south, as you know it's going to go south. See, because there's more to looking in each other's eyes to make a relationship. Yeah, once you start having children and raising all these things come into play. Samson wasn't thinking about that. You go and get somebody who's not even thinking about the Lord, then it's you against them because the Holy Spirit is not in it. And if you don't have a marriage that's bound by something, it can be easily torn apart. The scripture tells us that a threefold cord is not easily broken. That's why we ask you to get somebody who knows the Lord. And we ask the Holy Spirit to bless that union. It makes it more difficult for it to be torn asunder. Exodus 20 and 12 says, honor thy father and thy mother. Comes with a promise. If you do it, it says your days may be long upon the land that the Lord thy God is giving you. Samson thumbed his nose at his parents, did not believe them. Samson messed up because he turned away from his upbringing. Not only did he turn away from his upbringing, he also deserted his promise. Even though his mama raised him as a Nazarite, Mason, he adopted a Nazarite lifestyle. So it wasn't mama's promise, it was his promise. He agreed to continue being a Nazarite. And then when he was going down from his home to Tinith, where he met the girl he wasn't supposed to be around, the Bible says that a lion tried to come on him and he killed it. That's a violation. He's not supposed to be around anything dead, animal or person. So he's already violated. Not only that, he killed the lion in a vineyard. So he's violated two of the tenets. Being in a vineyard. This ain't mom and dad's fault. This is his fault. This is his choice. Being around a carcass, that's his fault. Not theirs. There are a number of other examples in scripture of people who have stepped away from their upbringing. And when you step away from your upbringing, it creates problems. If you go back and you remember Lot in the book of Genesis, Lot ended up being involved in all sorts of incestuous behavior with his own daughters. But he came out of Abram's house. How do you come out of this righteous man's house and then end up so unrighteous? And it's because the Bible says he went and pitched his tent on the borders of Sodom and cast his eyes there. And he sat there and he watched what was going on. And before long, you're not just watching what's going on, you're involved in what's going on. And it destroyed his whole house. And there are remnants of that still going on to this day. Created problems throughout scripture. So Samson dishonored his parents, and he deserted his promise, walked away from it. God can give you all the blessings in the world if you do what you're supposed to do, but you have the choice to desert it. And God won't stop you from walking away from your promise. So here we have this man who was brought up properly, who walks away from his parents, from his promise. And not only that, because he was already messed up and off track, it made him distort his purpose. All right, so here he is. He's found this woman in Tinith that he wants to marry. who he should not be marrying. He's also there with all the guests. He's trying to show out because he's got this spirit that comes upon him that makes him so wise, but he's a smart aleck. There's a difference in being smart and being a smart aleck. All right? Because being a smart aleck don't mean you got wisdom. God gives you wisdom. Yeah, just because you got a smartphone in your pocket don't mean it's smart. Yeah, phones don't have wisdom. Proverbs 13 and 20 says, he that walketh with wise men shall be what? Wise. But he that is a companion of fools shall be destroyed. When you don't ally yourself with the right folk, when you don't put yourself around the right people, you're going to mess up. Fight for who's around you. Don't keep standing around folk who keep getting in trouble. Because before long, you're going to get in the trouble they get into. I don't care if they're your brother, your cousin. At some point, you just tell them, my stomach hurt. I can't come tonight. I'm sorry, I can't be there. Get away from folk before your life gets away from you. This happens every day. Every day. You know, young folk, when Bebo come driving down the street, you know Bebo always in trouble. Don't get in the car with Bebo. Don't do it. I don't care how much he likes you. I don't care if you have to walk 20 more blocks. Do not get in the car with him, because just as surely as you do, something's going to get off. And the first thing you're going to say is, I was just trying to get a ride. And ain't nobody going to believe you, even though it's absolutely the truth. Don't put yourself in that situation. He distorted his purpose. He was in the wrong place. He gave a riddle. And the riddle had to do with the lion that he had killed. Nobody knew he killed it. He didn't tell his family or nobody. He's the only one that knew it. And his wife tricks him, or his wife-to-be, his fiance, tricks him into giving up the answer. And once he finds out he's tricked, he goes into a rage, and then he harms people, and he messes up. His purpose is all off. He's supposed to be there, Anthony, to save his people. Not there to fulfill his own passions. Not there to just get what he wants. See, some of you think that God let you go to college so you could be rich. That ain't your purpose. What purpose does it serve God for you to be rich? Now, that's not to say you might not be. But if that's the case, it too is for a higher purpose. And you ought to constantly be asking the Lord, Lord, what would you have me to do? Buy another house? Buy another car? How is that helping God's purpose? Samson had all the gifts, but the gifts only mean something if you are wise enough to use them. I'm not close to preaching prosperity, because I know too many folk who were born relatively poor and who died relatively poor, but who lived dynamic lives. Stuff doesn't equate to blessings. In fact, we spend too much of our time wasting time to keep stuff that detracts from us being able to do what the Lord wants us to do. Samson, if he had just stayed true to the course, would not have messed up his life like he did. God gives us good gifts and abilities, but we can't prostitute ourselves and use them for the wrong purposes. And he did. So not only did Samson mess around and dishonor his parents and desert his promise, not only did he distort his purpose, but lastly, he defiled his purity. How you come out born pure? And it just kept getting worse on him. After he messed around and messed up with the girl from Tenneth, who he ultimately did not get. She married his best man. He didn't get her. Came back after he had killed the 30 men to pay his riddle fee. And the father of the girl had married her off to his best man. And he said, but I got another one. And gave him the choice of marrying his other daughter. This is how immoral the family was. But he kept on, he left that, went on about his way. Still had a taste in his mouth for club women, though. And that's how he meets Delilah. And he finds himself in the same situation, to paraphrase, the same situation with Delilah that he was in with the girl from Tinith. Finds himself being a threat to all the folk in that community. And they want to know why he's so strong. How can he kill all these people? And so they sent their sister Delilah off to find out. And she does what she can do to find out. And that's when she comes in that scripture I told you. And she's saying, you make me look like a fool because my family wants to know why you're so strong and you won't tell me. She uses her womanly wiles to convince him that he ought to tell her. And because he is so brilliantly weak, he is magnificently weak. Oh, he's superiorly strong of body. But he is, let me find a big word, elephant. All right. He's elephant weak when it comes to women. You put whatever word you want in there. That's how weak he is. He fancies himself. He looks in the mirror and thinks he's as pretty as other folk think he is. Okay. And that's what he thinks his strength is. But his strength is not his hair. Even though he tells her, my strength is in my hair. You know what his strength was? His faith. Yeah. His strength was the faith to keep following the Nazarite vow. And by telling her his strength was in his hair, the Bible says clearly that he didn't know that God left him. So he's left there, Saul, thinking that his strength was in his hair, but his strength was in his faith. And when he didn't have faith enough not to tell her about his hair, God left him. He defiled his purity, messed himself up, and because of that, he ends up blinded, beaten, strung out, and he ultimately ends up killing the entire wedding party. Because he prays to the Lord for enough strength just to make it through that situation. Enough faith, Lord, give me enough. Do you know how good he could have been? Can you imagine how dynamic he could have been if he had just stayed true to his course? There are so many dynamic men and women who God has blessed who fall for flesh, who are weak for people. Not purpose, but people. And it ain't just women, it's wine, it's everything. And Samson, as mighty as he could have been. And you say, well, how does he end up in the Heroes Hall of Faith? And he does because his last act was an act of faith. And God blessed him with that last act of faith. Even after he had messed up and he was sitting in Delilah's hair salon trying to get his locks curled, even if he messed up and told her about all of that, he still, after caving in and telling her the truth, violating his Nazarite vow, ends up killing all these folk. He lost his power. But he didn't even know that his power was in his faith. And it was only in his loss that he actually found the power to go back into his faith. And by that time for him, it was too late. God will bless you. Some of you have a call on your life. Some folk in here have a call on their life and they don't know it. You think because you're around mediocrity all day that you're supposed to be mediocre. No, that's just to make you appreciate what you finally get when the Lord blesses you. That's what that does. Yeah, when God shows you where you are, it'll make you appreciate where he takes you. But you got to be true to him. You can't give up because sin will blind you. It'll tie you up. It'll keep you in knots. Sin will do that. Not only will sin bind you, Samson found out the hard way that sin will blind you. Because that's what happened to him. Yeah. But the longer you stay around it, the sin that binds you and blinds you will also grind you. Oh, it'll just tear you up. It'll mess up every single thing around you and chew up all the good stuff. And what I hate about sin is it takes the sunshine out of the day. It just messes you up. Just grinds and grinds away at you. And the closer you get to other folk, it's grinding them up too. Because your folk are trying to find a way to get you out of this binding, grinding, blinding sin. They're praying and crying and on their face before the Lord. And they don't know that the choice is yours. It's okay for us to intercede for somebody. But at some point, they got to pray for themselves. So I came to tell you that Samson messed up. Lord, he messed up. He had a call on his life just like somebody in here does. And I'm so glad that there was one who was more powerful. Nobody would have known him to be the wise one that he was. He didn't look like anything special. Just looked like a little old street preacher. Folk followed him because of the wisdom of his words. But do you know that this man who didn't look like much was more powerful than Samson? Do you know that? Do you know that this man who was born not with a silver spoon in his mouth, but who was born, how can I say it? He would have been born on government assistance. This man named Jesus. This man was born, his mom and daddy were basically homeless when he was born. He came from the exact opposite end of the spectrum than Samson. And yet he understood his purpose and his destiny from day one. And he walked in it through the ridicule. He talked in it through the opposition. And he died for it. And because of that, this man, we call his name is Jesus. This man, not only is he in the hero's book of faith, he's the author of it. And he came from nothing. He came from nothing that you and I would have paid attention to. And that's why I came to tell you today, God will bless you. It doesn't matter where you start. It doesn't matter your circumstances. What matters is if you're faithful. Stay faithful. Jesus was faithful. And because Jesus was faithful unto death, God blessed him with everlasting life. And that's why I follow him. I follow him. I'm here to tell you that God can raise you from meager beginnings. He can. He'll give you a name. He'll bless you. He'll give you a place to work. He'll bless you. All he asks is that you stay faithful. And my question to you today is, do you know him? Do you know him as your Savior? Do you know him as the one who died for you? Do you know him? I'm so glad I found him. I've never been strong in body. I've got my diversions, things that have gotten me off track. But since I met Jesus, I've been focused on doing what he wants me to do. And I'll tell you this right now, I'm going to follow him until the day I die. I'll leave here loving him. Because he left here loving me. My question to you today is, do you know? Don't let a tragedy in your life draw you to it.
Well, there it is. I hope you were blessed by God's word. It's my prayer that you will grow from this message. But in case you need a refresher, you can always stop by our physical location and worship with us at 7600 Division Avenue over in the East Lake community. I believe one visit and you'll find out that we truly are the friendliest church from the parking lot to the pulpit. Looking forward to meeting you. God bless you. Take care.